valley of the shadow of death. Your perfect love is casting out fear. And even when I'm caught in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back, I know you are near. And I will fear no evil, for my God is with me. And if my God is with me, whom then shall I fear? Whom then shall I fear? Oh no, never let go, in every high, in every low. Oh no,
Well, good evening, everyone. Glad to see you. I don't know if you can see my face. I got a little bit too much sun this afternoon, and looking at your rosy faces, some of you did as well. But what a beautiful afternoon it was. And I don't think we're going to get that kind of a blessing tomorrow. Maybe it's just as well, because we are right in that path of that 100% total eclipse. And it's one of God's great surprises that we get to see once in a while. I had a great surprise this morning. Pastor Frank noticed it as well. Of course, Trid Barna professed her faith in Christ. She claimed Jesus as her Lord and God. And as a gift, as a memorial to the day, Pastor Frank handed her this devotional called "Seeking God's Face." It's written by Phil Reinders. He's a pastor in Toronto, and you know, God is hilarious. God is funny. So today's devotional. There are a series of readings, but the one Bible reading is for today. Had no idea. It is John 20, verses 19 through 23. That was the text that I preached on this morning. I was following the Revised Common Lectionary, and that was set for that. And then Pastor Frank handed her the devotional, and he opened it up, and he's like looking at it, and wow, that's today's passage. And I just think that's hilarious. Have you ever had God intervene in your life and just give you a pleasant surprise that you didn't see coming? God is good, right? And all the time? God is good. Let us go with that spirit into worship tonight. Our call to worship is from Psalm 47. There's something for me to say. There is something for you to say. And those words, Lord willing, will be on the screen. There they are, right there. Because I don't see them on that one. So I'm just going to read off of this one. So, people, clap your hands, all you people. Shout to God with loud songs of joy. God has gone up with a shout, the Lord with the sound of a trumpet.
Sing praises to God, sing praises, sing praises to our King, sing praises.
If you are able to stand to receive God's greeting, do so. But if you cannot, just lift up your heart and receive God's greeting tonight. Grace to you and peace from God our Father, from His Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, through the power and the operation of the Holy Spirit. And all God's people say, Amen. Our gathering song is, "Oh, for a Thousand Tongues to Sing."
Oh,
We give you thanks, great God, for the hope that we have in Jesus, who died, but is risen and rules over all. We praise you for his presence with us. Because he lives, we look for eternal life, knowing that nothing past, present, or yet to come can separate us from your great love, made known in Jesus Christ our Lord. Receive our worship this day. May it be a fragrant offering before your throne of grace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our song of praise is Praise the Lord, sing Alleluia. Our scripture reading tonight before our offering is Hebrews chapter 11. One of our high school students in a catechism class asked the question about, what about all the folks from the Old Testament? They didn't know Jesus, they didn't see Jesus. Are they saved? And the Spirit said, Pastor Jeff, read them chapter 11. Of Hebrews. Now faith is being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we do not see. This is what the ancients were commended for. By faith we understand that the universe was formed at God's command, so that what is seen was not made out of what was visible. By faith Abel offered God a better sacrifice than Cain did. By faith, he was commended as a righteous man when God spoke well of his offerings. And by faith, he still speaks, even though he is dead. By faith, Enoch was taken from this life so that he did not experience death. He could not be found because God had taken him away. For before he was taken, he was commended as one who pleased God. And without faith, it is impossible to please God because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. By faith, Noah, when warned about things not yet seen, in holy fear, built an ark to save his family. By his faith, he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness that comes by faith. And by faith, Abraham, when called to go to a place he would later receive as his inheritance, obeyed and went, even though he did not know where he was going. By faith, he made his home in the promised land like a stranger in a foreign country. He lived in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who were heirs with him of the same promise. For he was looking forward to the city with foundations, whose architect and builder is God. By faith, Abraham, even though he was past age and Sarah herself was barren, was enabled to become a father because he considered him faithful who had made the promise. And so from this one man, and he as good as dead, came descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and as countless as the sand on the seashore. All these people were still living by faith when they died. They did not receive the things promised. They only saw them and welcomed them from a distance. And they admitted that they were aliens and strangers on earth. And people who say such things show that they are looking for a country of their own. If they had been thinking of the country they had left, they would have had opportunity to return. Instead, they were longing for a better country, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. By faith, Abraham, when God tested him, offered Isaac as a sacrifice. He who had received the promises was about to sacrifice his one and only son, even though God had said to him, "It is through Isaac that your offspring will be reckoned." Abraham reasoned that God could raise the dead, and figuratively speaking, he did receive Isaac back from death. By faith, Isaac blessed Jacob and Esau in regard to their future. By faith, Jacob, when he was dying, blessed each of Joseph's sons and worshiped as he leaned on top of his staff. By faith, Joseph, when his end was near, spoke about the exodus of the Israelites from Egypt and gave instructions about his bones. By faith, Moses' parents hid him for 3 months after he was born because they saw he was no ordinary child and they were not afraid of the king's edict. By faith, Moses, when he had grown up, refused to be known as the son of Pharaoh's daughter. He chose to be mistreated along with the people of God rather than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a short time. He regarded disgrace for the sake of Christ as of greater value than the treasures of Egypt because he was looking ahead to his reward. By faith, he left Egypt, not fearing the king's anger. He persevered because he saw him who was invisible. By faith, he kept the Passover and the sprinkling of blood so that the destroyer of the firstborn would not touch the firstborn of Israel. By faith, the people passed through the Red Sea as on dry ground. But when the Egyptians tried to do so, they were drowned. By faith, the walls of Jericho fell after the people had marched around them for 7 days. By faith, the prostitute Rahab, because she welcomed the spies, was not killed with those who were disobedient. And what more shall I say? I do not have the time to tell about Gideon and Barak and Samson and Jephthah and David and Samuel and the prophets who through faith conquered kingdoms, administered justice, and gained what was promised, who shut the mouths of lions, quenched the fury of the flames, and escaped the edge of the sword, whose weakness was turned to strength, and who became powerful in battle and routed foreign armies. Women received back their dead, raised to life again. Others were tortured and refused to be released so that they might gain a better resurrection. Some faced jeers and flogging, while still others were chained and put in prison. They were stoned. They were sawed in two. They were put to death by the sword. They went about in sheepskins and goatskins, destitute, persecuted, and mistreated. The world was not worthy of them. They wandered in deserts and mountains and in caves and holes in the ground. They were all commended for their faith, yet none of them received what had been promised. God had planned something better for us, so that only together with us would they be made perfect. you read those last few sentences, you know, and here we are in this country with this freedom. God is good. In that goodness and recognition of God's goodness, I ask the deacons to come forward and collect our offerings for this day. Let's bow our heads in prayer. God of life, your Spirit raised Jesus from dead. Your Spirit inspired the prophets and writers of Scripture. Your Spirit draws us even now to Christ and helps us to acknowledge him as our Lord. So we ask that you will send your Spirit even now to give us deeper insight, encouragement, faith, and hope through the proclamation of the gospel. In Jesus' name, amen. We are finishing up our journey through the prophet Malachi, and we're going to begin our reading at verse 13 of chapter 3 and then carry on through the end of chapter 4. You have said harsh things against me, says the Lord. Yet you ask, what have we said against you? You have said, it is futile to serve God. What did we gain by carrying out his requirements and going about like mourners before the Lord Almighty? But now we call the arrogant blessed. Certainly the evildoers prosper, and even those who challenge God escape. Then those who feared the Lord talked with each other. And the Lord listened and heard. A scroll of remembrance was written in his presence concerning those who feared the Lord and honored his name. They will be mine, says the Lord Almighty. In the days when I make up my treasured possession, I will spare them, just as in compassion a man spares his son who serves him. And you will again see the distinction between the righteous and the wicked, between those who serve God and those who do not. Surely the day is coming, It will burn like a furnace. All the arrogant and every evildoer will be stubble. And that day is coming. And that day that is coming will set them on fire, says the Lord Almighty. Not a root or a branch will be left to them. But for you who revere my name, the Son of Righteousness will rise with healing in its wings. And you will go out and leap like calves released from the stall. Then you will trample down the wicked. They will all be ashes under the soles of your feet on the day when I do these things, says the Lord Almighty. Remember the law of my servant Moses, the decrees and laws I gave him at Horeb for all Israel. See, I will send you the prophet Elijah before that great and dreadful day of the Lord. He will turn the hearts of the fathers to their children and the hearts of the children to their fathers, or else I will come and strike the land with a curse. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. I've learned even this past week, as a husband, as a father, and as also as a pastor, that criticism is always difficult to accept. But if I receive it with humility and a desire to improve either myself or my work, it can actually be very helpful. The Bible says in the book of Proverbs 13, verses 31 to 33, whoever heeds life-giving correction will be at home among the wise. Those who disregard discipline despise themselves. But the one who heeds correction gains understanding. Wisdom's instruction is to fear the Lord, and humility comes before honor. Only a fool does not profit when he is rebuked for his mistakes. When we are criticized, you know, we ought to ask ourselves whether the criticism contains any truth. Because if it does, we should learn from it, even when it's not really given with the right motivation and in the right spirit. So the other day I was reminded of four suggestions that can, well, help me and perhaps help each of us create a healthier response to criticism. So the first thing is, when you receive criticisms, commit that matter instantly to God, right there in that space. Ask God to remove all that resentment and counter criticism or defensiveness on your part, and let God teach you the needed lessons. Number two, when you receive criticism, remember that we're all great sinners, and the one who has criticized you or me or us does not even begin to know the worst about us. When you receive criticism, and if you've made a mistake or committed a sin, right there in that moment, humbly and honestly confess it to God and to anyone you may have injured. When you receive criticism, be willing to learn. Once again, you know, you are not infallible. You need to know God's grace. You need to know God's wisdom every moment of the day just to keep yourself on that straight path. So when we're criticized, let us all humbly accept what is true and then act upon it, thereby becoming a stronger person and maybe even a stronger community. Now, I know I normally start with a story, you know, but I'm flipping it around tonight. The application first. You see, the prophet Malachi, he had a critical eye when it came to the people of Judah and to the people of Jerusalem. They had returned from captivity. They were in Babylon. They were in Assyria. And the prophet brought the word of God to the people. You have spoken arrogantly against me, says the Lord. Yet you ask, what have we said against you? You've said, it's futile to serve God. What do we gain by carrying out his requirements and going about like mourners before the Lord Almighty? But now we call the arrogant blessed. Certainly, evildoers prosper, and even when they put God to the test, they just get away with it. There are two paths that the people of Judah and Jerusalem could take after a comment like that. They could either accept the prophet's words in good faith, confess their sin, and follow God, or they could just, you know, plain old ignore the word of God and to continue to go about their lives without any concern given to the prophet. What do you think, brothers and sisters? Which is the wiser of the two paths? Listen to the prophet, repent, follow God, or ignore the prophet altogether and just go about your business regardless of what the prophet had to say. Which is the wiser? Now, as it happened, there were a group of people in Jerusalem and Judah who feared the Lord. They got together. They talked about what the Lord had said through the prophet. They listened to God. They heard what God had to say. They feared God. They honored God. They worshiped God. And the names of those who feared the Lord were placed in a scroll of remembrance, the Bible says. The Lord spoke through the prophet. On the day when I act, says the Lord Almighty, they will be my treasured possession. I will spare them, just as a father has compassion and spares his son who serves him. And you will again see the distinction between the righteous and the wicked, between those who serve God and those who don't. Which is the wiser of the two paths? Should we fear the Lord Almighty, listen to the prophet and repent, or ignore God, ignore his word, ignore the prophet, and just go about our business again, regardless of what the prophet or what the Lord Almighty had to say? Which is the wiser? Surely, God says, surely the day is coming. It will burn like a furnace. All the arrogant and every evildoer will be stubble. And on the day that is coming, I will set them on fire, says the Lord Almighty. Not a root or branch will be left to them. But who will revere my name? The Son of Righteousness will rise with healing in its rays. And you will go out and frolic like well-fed calves. Then you will trample on the wicked. They will be ashes under the soles of your feet on the day when I act, says the Lord Almighty. Which is the wiser of the two paths? Those who revere the name of the Lord, or those who despise God's name and what God had to say? And as the people, you know, people of Judah and Jerusalem, they contemplated over what God had said through the prophet Malachi, the Lord gave them three considerations to ponder as they thought through their decision. God says, you know, consider the past. The word of God came to the prophet Malachi. He said, remember the law of my servant Moses, the decrees and laws which I gave him at Horeb for all Israel. Do you remember the words God spoke? All those many years ago, the tribe of Israel had been released by Pharaoh, but Pharaoh's anger still was raging and the people left Egypt. The Lord Almighty separated the waters of the sea and the tribe of Israel just passed right through. The waters crashed over Pharaoh and his army. The Lord Almighty stayed with his people, gave the tribe food and water, and the Lord Almighty brought them to God's holy mountain. I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an image in the form of anything, in heaven above or in the earth below or in the waters below that. You shall not bow down to them or worship them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sins of the parents to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord your God will not hold anyone guiltless who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath day to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, neither you nor your son or daughter, nor your male or female servants, your animals, or any foreigner residing in your towns. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea, and all that is in them. But he rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Honor your father and your mother, so that you may live long in the land the Lord God has given you. You shall not murder, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife or his male or female servant, his ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. Consider the past, God told the people. But God also said, consider the future. The word of God came to Malachi the prophet. See, I will send the prophet Elijah to you before that great and dreadful day of the Lord when it comes. So, Elijah, 1 Kings 18. The prophet Elijah, he had built an altar to God on Mount Carmel. Elijah took 12 stones, one for each tribe of Israel was placed together, and a trench was dug around those stones, and wood was placed on those stones, and a bowl was cut into pieces and placed on the wood, and four large jars of water was poured over that offering. Three times, separate times, and the offering was totally drenched. And Elijah prayed to God, Lord, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, let it be known today that you are God in Israel and that I am your servant and have done all these things at your command. Answer me, Lord, answer me, so these people will know that you, Lord, are God and that you are turning their backs again. Turning their hearts back again, sorry. Then the fire of the Lord fell and burnt up the sacrifice and the wood and the stones and the soil, and also licked up all the water in the trench. And on that day, the false prophets of Ahab and Jezebel were killed. So it will be one day in the future for those who choose to ignore the Lord Almighty. The Lord Almighty will destroy those who oppose him. But God is yet merciful. There's still time to repent. But even so, one day, God will be victorious. Consider the past. Consider the future. Now consider what you do in the present time. The word of God came to Malachi the prophet. God will turn the hearts of the parents to their children, and the hearts of the children to their parents, or else I will come and strike the land with total destruction. You remember the story of Zechariah, the Gospel of Luke, chapter 1? Then the angel of the Lord appeared to Zechariah, standing at the right side of the altar of incense. They're in the temple. When Zechariah saw the angel of the Lord, he was startled and he was gripped with fear. But the angel said to him, "Don't be afraid, Zechariah. Your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you will call him John. And he will be a joy and delight to you, and many will rejoice because of his birth, for he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He's never to take wine or fermented drink, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit even before he is born. He will bring back many of the people of Israel to the Lord their God, and he will go on before the Lord in the spirit and the power of Elijah, to turn the hearts of the parents to their children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteous, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord." Brothers and sisters, family of God, let us consider our past. Let us consider the future. And let us consider what we do in the present time in our homes, as a family of God. You know, to be sure, we place a whole lot of importance and weight on what we do here on Sundays, especially in our morning services. We also place a whole lot of weight and importance on what we do as a Christian community, especially in our schools and especially in our Christian institutions. But we need to hear what Malachi the prophet is really telling us this evening. Husbands and wives, fathers and mothers, children of all ages, the prophet Malachi is reminding us that the home is the school of the community. You know, at a very early age, and until the end of our age, on this side of glory, in the home, we are to learn about authority and about submitting to that authority. In the home, we are to learn about love and loyalty. In the home, we are to learn about obedience and trust. In the home, we are to learn about giving and receiving. In the home, we are to learn about God's grace and forgiveness in Christ Jesus. So, which is the wiser of two paths? The path of those who fear the Lord Almighty, or the path of those who are indifferent to what God has to say? What was the path of those who feared the Lord? Malachi tells us that the ones who feared the Lord, they talked with each other. And the Lord listened. And the Lord heard. And then Malachi tells us that a scroll of remembrance was written in the Lord's presence concerning those who feared the Lord and honored his name. You know, if you go to the Dunnville Memorial Arena, you'll see there in the lobby, there's a wall of remembrance. The names of the folks who have made a generous donation to the building fund of that facility, they're all kind of etched in stone on that wall. But brothers and sisters, heaven has a different kind of memory than that. And that memory has nothing to do with your power or privilege or property or your standing in the town. You see, a person standing before God must depend on his or her relationship to Jesus Christ. We bore witness to that this morning. You know, just like Jesus' disciple Thomas, Tridbarta said yes to Jesus as their Lord and God. May we be so wise each and every day. May we remember Jesus' words and choose wisely the path we would walk. You remember Jesus' words. He said, Matthew chapter 10, he said, whoever acknowledges me before others, I will also acknowledge before my Father in heaven. But whoever disowns me before others, I will disown before my Father in heaven. So brothers and sisters, all those who are participating here in this room and online today, tomorrow, or whatever day in the future, choose this day the one whom you shall follow, the Lord Almighty or yourself. Choose wisely. To God be the glory, great things he has done. Amen. Let's pray. Open our eyes, Lord God. Open our eyes to see your sheer goodness in coming to us in the person of your Son, to see the truth of who Jesus Christ is and then bow before him, to see the truth of the empty tomb and the resurrection appearances, that he was touched and seen and held, not the least by Thomas himself. Open our eyes, Lord God. Work faith in us by your Spirit. We ask of you, Lord God, to give to each one here the gift of faith. Give to each one of us the gift of faith, not in some merely one-sided and personal sense of the word, but faith to see what the truth really is, to help us see the right path, to help us understand what Jesus really meant when he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And then, Lord God, give us the strength, give us the courage, give us the integrity to bow down before you and say, Lord God, have mercy on me, a sinner. Open our eyes, Lord God. Bless this, your family, here at Bethel Christian Reformed Church. Bless our homes. Bless those who are single. Bless those who are married. Bless those who have families. May we continue to grow in the grace and knowledge of Jesus Christ. May we continue to honor your name above every other name, Lord God. May we continue to fear you, Lord God, because the fear of the Lord is the beginning of the wisdom, and knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. Open our eyes, Lord God. Show us the way. May we walk close to you, walk in your footsteps as you lead us day in and day out, so that we love the Lord our God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. We love our neighbor as ourselves. Open our eyes, Lord God. For Jesus' sake, we pray. Amen. Amen. Our song of response is, Before the Throne of God Above. You are invited to stand to sing if you so desire.
Forever lives and breathes.
God calls us to discipleship. God has shown you what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? To act justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with our God. May our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us and by his grace gave us eternal encouragement and good hope, encourage your hearts and strengthen you in every good deed and word. Amen. Let us praise God, from whom all blessings flow.